Hello and welcome to my channel. If you are starting a PhD or you have started a PhD recently, then this video is for you. In this video, I will explain 5 things that a PhD student must start as soon as possible when they start their PhD. So let's get started. Hello, my name is Tahir Yaqub, and if this is your first time, please hit the subscribe button and also the notification bell so that you can get notified whenever I post a brand new video on this YouTube channel every Tuesday and Friday. So let's start discussing what are those 5 things which a PhD student must start. So these things are listed already on this board, as you can see, but these things needs a little bit of explanation. So the first thing is buy a diary. When I say diary, it means a hardcover like leather or a plastic binded diary, which has a maximum page available for writing, not very wide headers and footers. Why you need a diary? You can use a copy or a notepad, someone might ask. But the thing is that the look and feel of a diary is different than a notepad or a copy or a register. And you better know that most of these notepads and copy, they end up mostly in dustbins. While your diaries, if you look on your previous diaries, you will notice that those diaries are still hanging around in your home somewhere. So diary is a kind of permanent record. You don't need internet to access the information you have. I use 2 diaries. One is a large diary and one is a small diary. Not very small, it's a hand-sized diary. So these diaries, when you put everything on these diaries, so don't be too selective. You have to make only one decision, whether this information is related to your PhD. If the answer is yes, you put on the diary. Because if you are too selective whether I should put this or not, then this diary will become useless. Because there are little things which you will need when you start writing your thesis, or when you start thinking about what you have done in the past. And these little things, these little success which you have in during your PhD will encourage you to keep going. Otherwise, you will not have some very big achievements each and every day. These are the little things which will pile up and you will end up having a PhD degree. Now, coming to the second point. The second point is start using LaTeX. So LaTeX is a typesetting software. And I have said enough on my YouTube channel about LaTeX. And it's not only because I teach LaTeX and I have courses about LaTeX and I want you to buy my courses. You don't have to buy my courses. The only benefit you get from buying a course is that you will get all the information at one place. Otherwise, I explain each and everything on my YouTube videos. So you don't have to worry about that. Why LaTeX is important? Because LaTeX is the only software which gives you professional quality when it comes to writing something, writing a research paper, writing your thesis. And it will save you hundreds of hours if you learn LaTeX. And this is the only problem with LaTeX, that there is a learning curve involved. You have to learn it. But once you have got a template ready for your thesis, then you don't have to worry about anything. It will take care of all your section numbers, your table numbers, your images, your references, whatever you want to refer, you can straight away put it there. And it will keep everything tied up and in a professional manner. And the fonts in LaTeX, they are wonderful. You cannot have these fonts in Word. And in Word, you cannot even handle pictures. If you put an image there, then you change something, your image will change. And if you open your document with 10 or 20 images, it will take maybe 5 minutes to open a document. I can say a lot about LaTeX, but this is enough for you that you must start using LaTeX if you are serious about having a professional style of documentation in your PhD career. Now, the third thing is making a file of your references. So in the first year of your PhD, and also when you are writing a paper or you are trying to find out other people's research work, you will be reading a lot of papers. And once you read those papers, what you should do is you should immediately try to capture the reference of that paper into a file. And that file is called BibTeX file. And I am talking with reference to the LaTeX, that I'm assuming that you are using LaTeX software. So in this BibTeX file, you will put the reference of every paper which you have read during your literature review or later on. And this will be a huge file. Maybe 2000 lines. And now I will jump on my computer and I will show you what I mean by capturing the reference of any research paper. And if you are using, for example, IEEE Explore database, this is one of my papers. And if you want the citation of this paper, the bib entry for this paper. So what you need to do, there is an arrow here which says download citations. If you click on this arrow, it will ask you which format you want. So if you are using LaTeX, you will select this BibTeX, and after that you just press download and you will get this file. Now you can just copy this from here like this, copy, and now I open my reference file, which is thesis.bib, and in this file at the end I can just after this bracket I can paste that entry. Very simple. So this keywords normally we don't want, and similarly this DOI. So just select all these and delete this, and now this entry is ready for you. If you don't need this ISSN number, most probably, so just delete this as well. And now your bib entry for this conference paper is ready. So this is how you start increasing on this file. Every paper which you want to include in your thesis or in your research paper, you just download the citation and put in this .bib file. And then I will explain you how to use this file in your thesis. Actually, I have already made a video which I will put a link here. So you can watch that video how to use this bibliography. This is another very popular database which is called ProQuest, and on this database downloading the citation is very easy. If you want citation of this paper, let's say, you just click on the left hand side on this box, and on the right hand side you just click on the cite, and when you click on cite it will show you this dialog box. You can straight away copy from this and paste into your bib file, or you can also download and you can send the email. So there are a lot of file formats available here, but we need this BibTeX. So downloading the citation from ProQuest is extremely easy. And here is another database, Web of Science. You can also download citations from this database. For example, you want citation for this paper, so you select this paper and then you export to other file formats, and in this file format you just have to select whether you want author title including the abstract. Most of the time we don't need an abstract, just the author title and source. Click on that and select the file format. There are other file formats available, but we need BibTeX, and then you just click export, and it will ask you to save the file, and you just save the file. I have already saved this file, so I just cancel this, close this from here, and when you open that file which we just downloaded, you will get this citation. And again, you can copy this and paste into your BibTeX file just at the end of this. So the thing to note here is that every database has a little bit different way of providing you the facility to download the citations. You have to understand that, but all database, they have this. You are able to download the citations from every database.
Now the fourth important thing is try to find out the top researchers in the field of your research. So why this is so important? This is important because if you are not aware of the cutting edge technology, if you are not aware of the frontier of the technology in your field of research, you will not be doing a PhD, because the PhD means that you are fully knowledgeable in that particular subject area. So if you don't know who is working who is leading the research in that field, then how will you know that what is going on, and how will you do your PhD? So this is very important. And you can get help from your supervisor. He will know many people who are leading in your field. But you can also search online, and I am going to show you how you can judge the value of a person with the perspective of research. It doesn't mean that he is not a good teacher if he is not a good researcher. It doesn't mean he is not a good professional if he is not a good researcher. What I am trying to explain here is that how to evaluate the body of research a person has done previously in his or her career. So I will again jump on my computer. I will show you how to find how valuable or how high quality a research work is.
So let us say I type my PhD supervisor's name and then the keyword citations in Google and search for this, and then I will get this result. So this is the name of my PhD supervisor and then Google Scholar citations. So if you click on that, you will get a record of all the citations
this person has. So, for example, my supervisor has 1,683 citations in all of his career. And these are some of the citations in recent years, which are very good. Because having a couple of hundred citations is considered very good to survive in an academic career. And this person has nearly 2,000 citations. And you can also see that whether the citations are roughly constant, are increasing or decreasing. So now I will show you one person who is leading in our field of robotics in the world. So this guy is Sebastian Thrun. And if you look at his citations, you will see that he has 99,000 citations. Since 2014, 38,000 citations, which is a very big number. So in this way, you can easily find who is the leading researcher in your field.
And now the final thing is, you have to find out the top journals in your field of research. So not only the top journals, but also the journals in which you can publish something. So what I suggest is, what I do, because on my small diary, I have made a page. On that page, I have selected maybe 15 to 20 journals, which have impact factors from 0.2 to 5. So this is a good range, which I think that good PhD student should be able to publish some publications in these type of journals. So from 0.2 to 5. So remember one thing, a conference is a conference. How valuable it might be, it has zero worth. It will give you zero benefit in your academic positions. When you will apply for a professor position or a lecturer position, a conference paper will give you zero value. And this was the mistake which I did during my PhD, because at that time there was a hype of publishing in IEEE conferences. And out of my 11 publications, 10 of those publications were in IEEE conferences. So this was wrong. I should have focused on journals. So therefore, I'm telling you this information that from the very early in your career, you should focus on publishing journal papers. And the way you should approach is that you make a list of papers, and in that list you collect 15 to 20 journals which have impact factors from 0.2 to 5, and then you try to read those papers papers from those journals as much as possible, and just read, and a time will come that when you will feel that you are absolutely ready to publish a paper in this journal. You will know how the people do experimentation, you will know what are different sections of a journal paper, and then you will be able to publish a journal. So always focus on journal papers and never ever focus on any conference. But at the same time, we need to publish something in the conferences for few reasons. So one of the reason is that when you go to a conference, you meet other people, and this interaction, collaboration is very important in the research. So therefore, if you are starting an experiment, your initial results, you should go for a conference paper. You can publish it, but a detailed result, a detailed analysis, a detailed experimentation, always focus on a journal. So try from a journal with impact factor like 0.2, and then later on you can have other journals like 1, 2, 3 impact factor. This impact factor changes every year. So what I do is, on my diary I have 3 years of impact factor, and I will show you maybe a glim image of that diary. And you can notice here that some journals, they are going up, and some journals are oscillating, some are going back. So the best chance for you to publish in a journal which has an oscillating impact factor, which goes up and down, because it means that their editorial board is a little bit flexible, and you might be able to publish a paper in that journal. So this is it, guys. I hope that you find this video useful. If so, please hit the like button and also subscribe to my channel. That will help me to grow my channel and to put more videos on this topic and on other topics and on the subjects which I teach. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.